Hi, and welcome to Maths Appeal. I'm Bobby Seagull.
And I'm Susan Okereke.
And why are we doing the Maths Appeal podcast series? We're both maths teachers, and we're strongly aware that there's a negative reputation in this country. And we're really excited about the subject, as you can tell, and we want to help try and play a small part in helping people reevaluate and think actually maths is quite a cool subject.
Yeah, we want people to be empowered by the fact that they can do maths, even if they find it difficult. That's then where the magic happens.
Exactly. Nothing wrong with finding something difficult.
Indeed. And so every week we discuss a fundamental key math topic. So Bobby and I discuss that as teachers, what people find difficult and how we deliver it. And this week our topic is multiplicative reasoning. Easy for me to say.
Got it there eventually. And then everyone who knows me knows that I like a puzzle. Then we have our weekly puzzle on that topic.
And every week we have a special guest interview from somebody else who loves maths. And so our special guest this week is Mike Ellicock, Chief Executive of National Numeracy Charity, an organisation that helps adults and children across the UK to improve their numeracy skills.
And then after that, you know, if you have a puzzle, you've got to have a solution. We discuss our solution to the puzzle. But before we get stuck in, we just want to say a big thank you for taking the time to download this podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you. We really appreciate your support. And I can see Susan now stretching her arms out this wide, really this much. Yeah, really.
Huge.
Appreciate your support in spreading the word. So if you can subscribe, give us a nice rating, follow us on Twitter or Instagram. We're at Maths Appeal. Or you can tell your friends about it. That would be great.
Right, so let's get stuck into some mathematics. Multiplicative reasoning is our topic for today. Before we go into the topic, we want to sort of explain how we set up this section. And this section, Bobby and I discuss as maths teachers how we think about the topic, how we then deliver it to our students, and then also some of the pitfalls our students have when they learn it, just to kind of break down what the topic is. So multiplicative reasoning as a definition that I've... Have you got one, Bobby?
Again, people try to explain the impact of it, but I didn't find a specific definition of multiplicative reasoning.
Well, I found one from the DfE, which I'll just read out just in case.
So I think the Department for Education.
Thank you for clarifying. I'm going to read it out because I've only really... the last year for me, I've kind of really found out how powerful this topic and wide-reaching this topic is. So definition from the DfE is: multiplicative reasoning refers to the mathematical understanding and capability to solve problems arising from proportional situations, often involving an understanding and application of fractions as well as decimals, percentages, ratios and proportion. So it's huge.
Lots of topics there. Yeah, it's really like fundamental topics.
And also it's a type of thing. So when I first started to think about it, and I'm actually doing some work with the NCETM, so that's the National Council of Excellence for Maths Teaching. And that's right.
Teaching of maths.
Teaching of maths, sorry. Thank you. And I've been sort of doing some work with a few of their maths hubs around this in the last sort of couple of years. And understanding the breadth of this topic and how it kind of touches majority of the content that we deliver in mathematics up to GCSE, it's kind of revolutionised my view of math teaching. So it's not... at first, when I first heard the term, I thought it was just to do with multiplying and dividing. Mm. And it's so much bigger than that.
Yeah, scaling, your area, your ratios, proportions. And if kids don't grasp multiplicative reasoning, it means that they're access to a lot of higher level topics, like whether it's trigonometry and you're rearranging an equation, you need to multiply things, that's just not accessible.
Totally. So it's that whole idea. So I think the key thing from the definition I get is that as you're increasing one thing by a scale, so by multiplying it, you're also doing it to sort of another, and it's the same as if you're dividing it, you're dividing it by that same scale. And what blew my mind when I first started thinking about it was the fact that it is in so many different topics. Like if you look at currency rates, you know, if you want to convert between pounds and euros or dollars, that is multiplicative reasoning. If you want to look at the scale of a map, and if you have to recreate that, drawing the scale and looking at similar shapes, that is also multiplicative reasoning.
These are all practical things that people need, not just at school, but in real life.
Yeah. Actually, one of the challenges we were giving when I went on some training was to think of a topic that doesn't include multiplicative reasoning. And that's something I'm going to put out to our listeners, because we did, we talked about it a lot in our training session, and no one could really find something.
So did everything come back to, oh, there needed to be some reasoning for multiplication?
Yeah, that I think we kind of came to. So if you do think of anything, do please let us know on our Twitter and Instagram at Maths Appeal. But when it comes to delivering it, to teaching it, the issue I sometimes have is what strategy to use, because there are now so many. Before, you know, I would maybe have taught ratios differently to how I might have taught things like scale in maps or things like proportional questions.
Yeah.
But now I try and do them all with the same similar strategy, but I'm trying to work out what my favourite is. So I like the idea of using a bar model to do it. Also, have you heard of double number lines?
Yeah.
So it's like you have, you know, recipe question where it's like,
oh, you're getting me hungry now. I don't get recipes.
So. We all love biscuits. So we say you have a recipe question where it's to make, say, 4 biscuits, you need 100 grams of something. You can then have your number of biscuits and your 100 grams is 4, and then you can then scale down the way. So to make 2 biscuits, how many would that be? And then you could, that would be 50, and then to make 1 would be then 25, mm-hmm. and then you could then scale up to make 11 or to make 30. And again, I'll just put a visual of that on our Instagram. So double number lines are amazing. Also, there's an arrow as well. That
I'm not seeing this arrow. What's this?
So again, if we have 4 biscuits is equivalent to 100 grams, but underneath it, you kind of maybe scale down to 1. So that means you've divided by 4 on both sides.
Okay.
And then that then gives you 100 grams becomes 25 grams.
I've seen that in ratios before.
Yeah. So how do you go about it?
So I think, firstly, I try and establish what level of understanding or recall do students have of the times tables, because times tables to me are quite important for multiplicative reasoning. But they'll go at this time, and if kids haven't got that sort of recall of 3 times 4 is 12, I'm gonna have to go back to actually showing them what does that mean. So 3 times 4, I might use an interlocking tower or blocks,
yeah,
or arrays. So 3 rows of 4 dots, is that correct? If they've got that, then I can progress them onto other topics. But I now learn increasingly not to assume that they've got that recall. Because I know there's a distinction between someone that can recall 7 times 6 is 42 and someone that understands what that actually means.
Yeah.
But I always go, actually, do they even know it in the first place?
I suppose without that core conceptual understanding, proportional questions become impossible. Because as you say, being able to say that 7 times 6 is 42, that doesn't necessarily mean that you know that that is 7 lots of 6 things, which actually, without knowing that, you are not going to be able to kind of attempt sort of proportional style questions. So again, I think the visual element is really important. But I think one of the issues I think I have, having learnt a few of them now, is what ones do you share? And if you share a variety, how do you do that without confusing students? And I'm learning myself. I think it's the whole idea of practicing using them. I think you'll see some of them with the puzzles that you give. I try to use kind of visual representations because I think it can make problems a lot easier. But the conceptual understanding needs to be there for people to be able to use those strategies.
Yeah, and what I find is that with whole numbers, integers, there are some students that feel, I think I've got it. I understand, you know, 7 lots of 6, what that means. But then as soon as you introduce, let's say, fractions, imagine we did 1/7 times 1/6.
Oh, gosh.
Then they start getting confused.
But again, I think that's, again, where the power of a diagram can really demystify it. Because I think if you're working always with abstract numbers, and you're not really connecting them to what that means in a visual or real setting, that's where confusion can lie. Because I think there's loads of procedures, you know, different ways of working stuff out. You know, if you were to find, 3/4 of something, you know, that divide by the bottom times by the top. There's all these things that are kind of rote.
Yeah, learned. The operation, how you mechanically.
But what does that actually mean? And once you understand the meaning, it's like, then you can effectively use that strategy for any question.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the time, especially when it comes to GCSE style problems, the issue a lot of students have is reading the question, understanding what it is, and then working out what to do. And that's where understanding is really, really essential. And, you know, being able to problem solve because you conceptually understand what's happening. And that I think, just takes time.
It does. I actually noticed the new GCSEs do have more proportional reasoning type questions.
Yeah.
So if kids are going out there in the real world trying to make a cake and they've got their proportions incorrect, you know, we're going to have a whole nation of bad cake makers and we can't afford that.
And especially with Bake Off being so, you know, huge.
Yeah.
As we say, multiplicative reasoning is a huge topic and it's kind of a core one that can make many of the topics that we learn actually one topic. And it'd be great to hear what different people's strategies are. You know, we're going to share on our Instagram and Twitter some of our examples of, you know, double number lines, bar models, the arrows. But if does anyone have any other suggestions, we'd love to hear from you at Maths Appeal. So, Bobby, I think it's puzzle time.
Exactly. Again, rubbing my hands in glee. So you, Susan, run a pet shop with two hamsters called Victoria and Albert. Victoria gave birth to 10 baby hamsters, five male and five female. These particular hamsters can breed when they are 4 weeks old. And their babies are born after 2 weeks of pregnancy. So each female hamster will only have one litter and all the litters will have 10 babies, split exactly between five boys and five girls.
Right.
So your puzzle is, how many hamsters will there be in total after 12 weeks?
Okay, right. Okay, I think you might have to go through that one more time.
Quite a few numbers, yeah.
Yeah, but it's just trying to think of the order of things. So one more time.
Okay, so you've got two hamsters, Victoria and Albert.
Sure.
And they've given birth to 10 baby hamsters. Five are male, five are female.
Wonderful.
And these hamsters can breed when they're 4 weeks old.
Right.
And their babies are born 2 weeks after the pregnancy.
Right.
And each female hamster only has one litter. And all the litters have 10 babies split exactly between five boys and five girls. So using this information, after 12 weeks, how many hamsters will there be?
Right. So got that noted. Thanks, Bobby. Okay, so while you're thinking about that, and I'm thinking about that, let's hear from Mike Ellicock, the Chief Executive of National Numeracy.
So Susan spoke to him a little while ago, and I'm really looking forward to hearing this conversation because I've got a personal interest in National Numeracy as one of their ambassadors. Over to you, Mike and Susan.
My name's Mike Ellicock. I'm Chief Exec of independent charity National Numeracy. So National Numeracy was founded in 2012. I was involved in that. And we're all about enabling everyone in the UK to be confident and competent to use numbers and data so that they can make good decisions in their daily lives.
Why does it exist?
There was an independent report or a report written by a charity think tank looking at what charities are doing around maths and numeracy. There's a load of charities out there, probably six, broadly around literacy. So the National Literacy Trust, Book Trust, Reading Agency, trying to help people, you know, who struggle to read and write to build those skills across the age range. And so they recommended that a organisation be set up roughly equivalent to the National Literacy Trust to bring the attention onto numeracy. And the real driver for that was the Skills for Life survey data of adult skills in the UK, which showed that from 2003 to 2011, the literacy levels had actually improved quite substantially. So from 44% of the population to 57% of the population working at level two, which is roughly equivalent to a GCSE pass in literacy.
Mm-hmm.
On the numeracy side, it had gone the wrong way and from a much lower base. So from 26% of the population in 2003 to 22% of the population in 2011. So,
sorry, 22% of the adult population
are at level two.
And that's a GCSE equivalent.
Yes, yeah, equivalent to a C or a four at GCSE.
So that's almost 80% are not.
Yes, 78%. Of the adult population could not do a kind of foundation tier GCSE question or, you know, sufficient to get a pass. Yeah, that's correct.
What are those actual numbers?
So depending on whether you do it on the working age population, but it's around 30 million adults. There's about 40 odd million working age adults.
Yeah.
And depending on exactly how you cut it, it's... One of the numbers that we used when we launched actually was 17 million adults working at primary school levels. So that's the next level down. So the two key stats, quite easily mathematical as well, is half the population are working at primary school levels and three quarters of the population, it's a bit more, but roughly three quarters of the population are working below the level we expect of a 16-year-old.
Yeah.
So our big drive, and we're very interested in what's going on in schools, but the main, in schools, as you well know, Susan, it's initiative overload. Yeah. The politicians like pulling levers and things keep changing all the time. Whereas when you get out of the school system, it's nothing. There's absolutely nothing innovative going on, and very little support, and actually diminishing support, diminishing spend for anyone who wants to either brush up on their numeracy skills or actually, become numerate for the first time. Yeah. So we spend most of our time and energy thinking about the stock of adults. So if we think about the flow through the system and then the stock of adults, so yeah. There are 20, 30 million adults who definitely need support in terms of their numeracy skills. There are about 700,000 kids in each cohort going through the school system who obviously need support. There's a lot of support there. They're a captive audience. Once you get out the back of that, it's a bit of a desert. Yeah.
Wow. So your charity is effectively targeting adults who need support and want support.
Yeah. I mean, we're cradle to grave in terms of our interest. So we're very interested in parents. We've got something called a Family Maths Toolkit, which I'd recommend your listeners search and have a look at online. But our main tool is the National Numeracy Challenge. So that's an online adaptive assessment. It's multiple choice. You can access it on a phone. You register and then you get presented with an assessment. It takes between half an hour, 45 minutes to work through, and it works through the different areas of maths, and you get a score at the end of it.
So it's like a test.
Yeah.
It's an interactive test.
Yeah, it's an assessment, and it's adaptive. That's one thing to bear in mind. So people who are a bit more numerate, if you keep answering questions right, you get harder and harder questions. So you'll get questions that go up into kind of level three questions. And they're built around something that we developed with Lynn McClure at Cambridge Maths and various other mathsy people, plus businesses, unions, called the Essentials of Numeracy. So what we tried to do was think of, if you start with a blank sheet of paper and you think of demand pull rather than supply push, mathematics education has basically been driven by supply push. So you get some mathematicians and some politicians together in a room and they decide what everyone needs to study in maths.
A curriculum.
Yeah. And that is pretty historic. When we look at what we study in maths, particularly through secondary maths, a lot of it we don't really use in the real world. And that's fine. We're not necessarily knocking that. Some of that's good kind of brain exercise. But what we're really interested in is, do people have confidence and competence so they can use numbers and data in daily life? So the Essentials of Numeracy, right at the center of it is being numerate, which is about decision making, problem solving and reasoning, and then the kind of tools of maths around the outside.
Well, it's a combination of things. I definitely feel that should be happening more in schools, but also once people have done the test, then what happens?
Yeah, so that's crucial, and lots of people think the National Numeracy Challenge is just a test. We call it the checkup. Okay. After that, people can get, if you get more than 80, you've got the Essentials of Numeracy.
Okay, so you're in that 20 something percent.
You're in the 22% theoretically. If you get less than 80, then you get rooted into learning resources. And what we've done is curated about 700-800 learning resources from all kinds of different sources, BBC Skillswise, places like that, Khan Academy, actually there's a few in there, to focus on the areas that people struggled with. Okay. So that's the basic idea. So you get a spiky profile, then you'll get rooted into resources, and people can click out, do something, click back in. At any time, they can take the checkup again and they can improve. So our kind of essential model, apart from the Essentials of Numeracy, essential model is this thing around building mathematical resilience. And we think there's three elements to that. The first is about value. The second is about mindset. And the third is about effort. We come some kinds called belief or mindset. So the value piece is, why is this relevant to me? Now, of course, as a secondary maths teacher, you get that all the time. Yeah. And the reality is some is directly relevant to people being able to manage their finances or whatever else. Some elements of secondary school maths are less directly relevant, but they're still good stuff to do. Once you recognise that this is important, once you recognise there isn't a maths gene that you don't have, or rather every human has the genetic makeup to be numerate, but you're going to have to put one foot in front of the other.
You've got to sort of put some effort in.
Yeah, put some graft in. And that's the same with everything.
Fantastic. So what's your story? How did you get involved in this?
that's probably longer than the interview. But going reverse chronologically back, when the report was written suggesting something like this get set up, I was working for Oxford University Press because I ran a business called Numacon, which so that was my business, set up by my mother-in-law, who was a primary school head teacher and an academic from Brighton University. So I ran that business, and then we ended up selling it to Oxford University Press. And the really interesting thing about Numacon, it was involved in the Every Child Counts program, which was a government initiative. And we found that where local authorities embedded the use of Numacon effectively with training from our team, every single child in that LA in year two, it was a year two intervention, made over 20 months improvement in their maths age.
Oh, wow.
In a 12-week intervention.
It's almost 2 years.
Yeah, so it was really, and that was every child who was on the intervention. Wow. And the intervention was targeted at the bottom 5% of kids in year two. So that kind of got me thinking. Yeah, at the same time as setting up National Numeracy, I set up a startup in a completely different space. I used to be a professional athlete, so it was to do with hydration and stuff like that. But that was kind of my route into this mathsy space, was running Numacon. Before that, I worked in the city for HSBC as a corporate banker. Before that, I did an MBA. Before that, I was an officer in the parachute regiment for 7.5 years. And it was actually being an officer in the parachute regiment is one of the big motivators for really shouting about the problems around GCSE at the moment, particularly the fact that the bottom third automatically fail. That's how it works, because it's a cohort reference system. Because pretty much all of my soldiers had failed GCSE maths, English.
Wow.
And then you have to pick them up in the workplace, because of course you need to be numerate to be a soldier. Or to be a healthcare assistant, or to be a nurse, you know, or to be an early years practitioner, or whatever else, and yet,
or a hairdresser,
definitely, and so we're automatically telling a third of our 16-year-olds you can't do maths by default, and I think that's just a travesty. I think the reason why that doesn't get the airtime it deserves is because they're other people's children. They're not politicians' children. They're not people that the commentarati, the journalists, the whatever else, are pretty sure that they can get their kids either, you know, into that top two thirds, or if they're pretty dodgy, they'll pay for some tutoring or whatever. So it's because I think it's other people's children are those that are in the bottom third, and we're automatically telling them they fail, and that's pretty stupid
awful.
As a system.
Yeah, yeah.
And we've got data for, so in the National Numeracy Challenge, if your listeners have a go at that, there's 26, it's about to be reduced to 21, attitudinal questions. Mm. And we can map that across 7 different variables. One of them's around maths anxiety. Mm. What we found from that data, and it's 40,000 people's data now, is the 16-year-olds have the highest level of maths anxiety, higher than 17-year-olds. And then that drops and drops to the age of 25, and then it pretty much plateaus. Okay. So it would suggest that our education system is creating maths anxious young people, which is exact opposite of what we want. We want them to be coming out of the system confident and competent to use numbers and data so they can go on with life.
So thanks to Mike Ellicock, Chief Executive of National Numeracy.
It's actually in May 2018, under sort of Mike's stewardship, National Numeracy had its first ever UK's National Numeracy Day. And there was one stage where I was on BBC Breakfast with Rachel Riley talking about numeracy. Mm. And then Martin Lewis, another ambassador, was on ITV. So we were on BBC One and ITV talking about the importance of numeracy. And I'll show you one of the things that we ask people. And this is a question that half of the adults in the UK can't get right with or without a calculator. So here's the question. You're earning £9 an hour.
Yep.
And your boss gives you a 5% increase on that. Half the adults in the UK cannot get this right with or without a calculator.
But then what that shows, because we're going to be doing percentages in our next episode, but what that shows is that this is essential for people's lives.
Yeah.
People who are going to be working need to be able to work out if there has been an increase or a decrease in their wage.
They just can't.
But then that's why we're here, Bobby.
No, we're here to help to change that.
Because that's huge. That's, you know, that's people's actual lives. And that's half of the population of this country.
Yeah, it's just shocking. Again, I did an assembly with my year sevens in my school recently. And I said, hands up who thinks they're not good at maths. And a lot of hands went up. Let me put you a question here. And I put that question up on the board.
Mm.
And most kids were able to say, okay, 10% is 90p. Half of that 5%, 45p.
Yeah.
Add it on, 945. And I told the kids, if you can get that, you've got a skill that's better than half of the adults in the UK, and that's...
But then what was amazing about, and really quite sad about what Mike was saying, was he was talking about how every year we sort of are effectively generating young people who are going to become adults who are like maths anxious, which, you know, like in school, there's a lot of, it's high stakes because loads of school, every school, their maths results and English results are kind of what the school is judged on regarding league tables. So it's high stakes for teachers to try and get kids through these exams. Doesn't really matter how good the quality of their learning has been. They just want the results to
just
be good.
On that exam day in May and June, you can regurgitate all the maths.
And then you're free and you've got your result. But that's not the real world we live in, because all these people are then meant to be going into the workplace and should effectively be competent mathematicians to do basics like work out if they've got a wage increase. Mm-hmm. But what's sad is that's not the case. And, you know, also, it's not the case. And plus, those people who are now young, from young people to adults, there's hardly any support for them. That's why this charity is so important, because without it, there's what, five different charities for literacy?
Yeah.
And they're like the only one for numeracy, which is insane.
Yeah.
Because it's such a need. Like, his chat really blew my mind, because I'd not really thought about the extent of the numbers. Like 30 million adults.
Yeah. And the numbers are staggering. And again, I've got in front of me a copy of their latest almost like brochure of what they do. And it says here that the total cost of the UK economy is £20 billion a year. And for every individual, it's £460 because of poor numeracy. So this didn't, you know, it's not just like an ethereal, oh, you should know your trigonometry and your Pythagoras. It's actually hitting your back pocket, because people can't work out whether an exchange rate they're getting at the travel agents or whether...
It's a good one or
yeah,
not.
Yeah, because they can't sit down and understand the mechanics of numbers.
Well, yeah. That's kind of exactly why we're doing this really, isn't it? Because I think I've gone from shock to just thinking, well, this is definitely a need. And it's a myth. I think what Mike Ellicock and the charity are doing is so wonderful. And I think actually it's such an important part of our society that we need to start shifting this as a taboo. It's something
attitude
that
needs to change.
It needs, and it's in a way that it's not just, oh, I can't. It's you can and you must, you know, for yourself and for your kids. And actually the support for you, I think he was sort of talking about the Family Maths Toolkit, which is on the National Numeracy website. So if you're interested in sort of doing stuff to support your kids, you should definitely look into that. Also, the National Numeracy Challenge. So that's where, if you're an adult and it's something that's always been an issue for you, your maths kind of skills, and it's something that's maybe in a bit of something that you want to fix, go onto the website, do the little test, and start to get better. You know, it's an incredible tool. It's completely free, and it's also support if you need it. So however bad you think you might be now, you can and you should get better.
Exactly. So it's nationalnumeracy.org.uk, and we also tweet out links to it and other learning resources. So head on over to @MathsAppeal for more information, and let us know how you get on if you take the National Numeracy Challenge.
Yeah, we'd love to hear your good stories. We'd love to hear positive math stories. So Bobby, let's get back to your puzzle. Can you remind us of the question? And let's kind of go through the answers.
Yeah, so the question was, Susan has a pet shop.
I don't.
With two hamsters, Victoria and Albert. And Victoria gave birth to 10 baby hamsters, 5 male and 5 female. And these hamsters can breed when they're 4 weeks old, and then their babies are born after 2 weeks of pregnancy. Mm-hmm. That's 6 weeks there. So each female hamster only has one litter, and the litters have 10 babies, and it's always going to be 5 boys and 5 girls. So how many hamsters are there at the end of 12 weeks?
Okay, so I have to say, when you first said this out loud, I was a bit like, there's a lot of information.
A lot, yeah.
And then I wrote it down, yes. And I did a little table and a bit of a diagram. And so I think I sort of worked out that from week zero, so where you sort of start, you've got Victoria and Albert, you've got 5 males, 5 females. Okay,
correct.
So that's 12. And then after 6 weeks, so you've got your getting to maturity and then getting pregnant and then having the babies, which is 6 weeks. Each of the 5 females then have a litter of 10. And then there's 5 males, 5 females in each litter. So that's after 6 weeks, there is an extra 50 hamsters.
Correct.
And then of those 50, 5 of the females in each litter has another 10.
Correct.
So that's 50 times 5, which is 250. So adding that all together, 12 plus 50 plus 250, which is 312.
And that's the number I have here.
Boom.
Boom.
And I will show, again, we're going to show our solutions on Instagram and Twitter at Maths Appeal. But yeah, like, it was one of those things when it started, I was like...
Because there's a lot of information. I would say sometimes with maths problems, especially ones that you listen to, you might, oh, I got the answer straight away. Whereas this one does require you to write, get a pen and paper for sure, write down the key information, distill it. And then, like, Susan's got a lovely little diagram showing how she's worked it out.
I do love a table.
You do.
I do love a table.
Yeah. She likes IKEA as well.
Yeah, I do. So I have to say, I did feel quite satisfied.
Yeah.
When I'd done it, yeah. But it was, I did feel at first when you started speaking, I was like, that's a lot of words and numbers, but I feel very satisfied with myself.
And that's it from us. Thanks again for downloading this episode of Maths Appeal. If you fancy subscribing, telling your mates to subscribe, or giving us a 5-star rating, that'd be amazing.
And our guest next week is Gareth Jones, who you may know better as Gaz Top, one of the presenters of How To from back in the day. And he's going to talk to us about his love of maths and science.
Oh, I love that guy's programme. Before we go, one final bit of maths trivia. And again, this is taken from the cuts of my book, The Life-Changing Magic of Numbers. So here's a quote from Alice's Adventure in Wonderland by Lewis Carroll. So she says in chapter 2, 4 times 5 is 12, and 4 times 6 is 13, and 4 times 7 is, oh dear, I shall never get to 20 at this rate. And it sounds all jumbled up, yeah?
Yeah, I think she's made a few mistakes.
4 times 5 is 12, but there are people out there on the internet that have said actually she's using a different base system.
Oh.
So 4 times 5 is obviously 20 in our base system, but right. If you use base 18, where the first column, as it were, is all units, and the second column is all 18s,
yeah,
and the third column is 18 squareds.
Oh, whoa.
So it's actually, you know, 4 times 5 is 12 in base 18, and 4 times 6 is 13 in base 21. So there you go. Alice in Wonderland is just working in a different base system to us.
But two different base systems.
Yeah. And actually, I think the last one, she even worked in base 24. So yeah, multiple base systems.
That is a trippy book.
The next time you read Alice in Wonderland, you know, there's maths in there.
It's everywhere, Bobby. Yeah. So thank Bobby, and thank you for listening. Maths Appeal is presented by Susan Okereke and Bobby Seagull.
And the music's composed by Kelly Okereke. The image design is by Kellex Davis. And the producer is the wonderful Jenny Nelson.